Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to this session entitled Latin America and the World. My name is Erik Schatzker. I'm an editor at large with Bloomberg Television. It is a great honor and pleasure for me to be here back in Buenos Aires, one of my favorite cities in the whole world, and back with the World Economic Forum, an organization with which I have spent much of my time over the past several years, most of it in Davos. This is my first opportunity to be at a Latin America WEF. I'd like to begin by reminding everybody that there are some rules of common courtesy that we'd like to observe here. Please, if you have to take a phone call, do it outside the plenary hall. Mute your phones, if you would be so kind, or put them on vibrate so that we don't disturb not just your fellow members of the audience, but more importantly, the panelists and the flow of the conversation. I'd be most grateful, and I know they would as well. I'd like to introduce to you the panelists here. And before I do, remind everybody that there will be an opportunity to ask questions. I hope you have come armed with many probing, perhaps edgy questions, and I encourage you to take the opportunity when I make it available to you some 40 minutes from now. But without further ado, to my left, I'd like to introduce you to Susana Malcorra. She is the Minister of Foreign Affairs and Worship here in Argentina. She came to government after a 25-year career at IBM and Telecom Argentina and distinguished roles at the World Food Program and the United Nations, including as Chief of Staff to the Secretary General. To her left, you'll see Ricardo Luna. He is the Foreign Minister of Peru. He is a career diplomat, a former ambassador to the UN, to the US, to the UK. He's a visiting has been in international relations at Princeton, Columbia, Brown, Harvard, and Sciences Po in Paris. To his left, you see Hans-Paul Berkner. To your right, my left. Hans-Paul Berkner, he's the chairman of the Boston Consulting Group, one of the world's top consulting firms, it goes without saying, and also the brains behind concepts corporations now take for granted, like stars and dogs, the experience curve, and the advantage matrix. Hans-Paul has more than, in his tenure as CEO, he more than doubled BCG's size. And finally, at the end of the row here, we have James Im. He's the CEO of EJ McKay and Company, a Shanghai-based investment bank with offices around the globe. James has more than 20 years of experience as a banker and a consultant. You will have seen on the program that Michael Rake, the chairman of BT, was to join us, unfortunately, due to, what's going on outside. He was unable to make it to Argentina on time. I'm delighted that the rest of you were, and that our panelists were, although Susana here didn't have far to travel. As you can see, these people all have extraordinary resumes and make me feel very, very inferior. So,
we don't believe that.
I think the right place to begin is by talking about the question we've been asked to answer. How can the region navigate the new global realities and strengthen its position in the world? I believe we need to define, first, the new global realities, and consider why they're relevant to Latin America. So to my panelists, I put that question to begin the conversation. We may think they're obvious, but what are the new global realities? Hans-Paul, why don't you begin?
Yeah, actually, we always talk about a new normal or new normal, and new realities. I think, of course, we have been seeing changes over the last years since the financial crisis in North America and Europe. But the question is, you know, what has really changed? We have somewhat slower growth, which of course has made life in many countries more difficult. We have higher unemployment, not everywhere, but in quite a number of countries. And that has put more pressure on the peoples, but also on governments and on companies. And I think one of the key challenges we now see is that there is more aversion towards openness, towards globalization. People questioning whether this has really benefited them, even though clearly, I mean, the world is in a much better stage today, and most people are much better off than they were 20, 30, 40 years ago, but still we need to listen to this. And I think it's very important not to disrespect people by calling them, okay, they're just following populists, they don't understand what's going on. I think the new reality is that we need to ask ourselves the tough questions. How can we deal with those challenges with the people who are dissatisfied better? Because if we don't, there will be more election results which we may not like, and there may be even social unrest, and I think we need to address that. I'm not sure that we are reversing globalization, even though some of the rhetorics that we are hearing are quite bad. I think that will probably normalize over the coming years, but we certainly need to address the issues of people who feel that they have been left behind, even though maybe in absolute terms they are not worse off, but in relative terms they feel they are left behind. And I think we need to take it seriously and not be disrespectful or even arrogantly disregarding those needs.
I thought that was an excellent way to begin this conversation, and I suppose I have to congratulate you, Hans Paul, for answering a question like that without using either the word Trump or populism.
Well, I said populism once, but I...
Oh, forgive me.
Anyway.
Let's continue.
Well, if I might just say that I agree with what you just said, but I think that we really have on our hands a major break in the premises that were set forward when the process of globalization became universal and accelerated, and when it went into a crisis mode after the financial crisis. Because basically, because of the T word you don't want me to use, or the P word that you don't want me to use, is
Donald
in fact
Trump,
there.
Don't be afraid of it.
There's nothing to be afraid of.
is part of the reality. Not only part of the reality, I think that we have to understand why these anomalies take place, and I think the origin of this impatience and irritation with the facts of life, that despite the growth, despite the universality and the perfectibility of the model of globalization, the immediate benefits have not really accrued to a large part of the populations. And this is the first time it's actually happened at the heart of the developed world. And so the questioning comes not only from North America and from Britain vis-a-vis Europe, but two countries or two leaders of what was the post-Bretton Woods world order. So you have an implosion from the heart, which is being abetted by social irritability, social impatience. None of this is going to make a model that will replace either the process of globalization or construct an awkward system of international relations. But clearly, it makes the combination of both the process of globalization in this sort of involution and the unpredictable nature of what is likely to succeed to replace the current model completely dysfunctional. So this is something that we have to be aware of. The first globalization process, which took place literally 500 years ago, was when Mexico was present in 1517 in Montezuma, and the Portuguese sent a mission to Canton and Macau. Between then and now, lots of things have happened. But globalization is here to stay, despite the threats of this ambiguous nationalism of an economic nature, which is curiously tied up with a retrenchment from the global indispensable power. Thank you.
Normally, I should speak Spanish. I apologize to my colleagues and friends and fellow citizens, but I think so as to keep a more convenient conversation flow, I will switch to English, so my apologies for that.
Build on what has been said. First of all, I think that what has happened is that there has been a distancing between the peoples and their leaders. Citizens feel essentially that their concerns, their worries, their uncertainties are not addressed by the leadership, political leadership, and leadership at large, and that has created a agitation in the world, and we have seen that translated into the way people have expressed themselves through casting their ballots. But I also believe that there is a big confusion in why is it that there is uncertainty, what are the reasons, the deep reasons, why people feel that their future may not be as bright as they would like, why people believe that their children may not have as good opportunities as they would like. And there has been a mixture of globalization, as was just explained by my predecessors, and another reality, which is the disruption of technology. And my sense is that a lot has been given to globalization as the reason for our concerns and worries, instead of tackling what is the real deep issue, which is technological disruption is recreating the demand for jobs in a manner that has no precedent in history, at a speed that has no precedent in history. So we are at a point where we talk a lot about the root causes of what has brought us to where we are, as explained by my predecessors, but we are essentially given the wrong reason to why is it that we are here.
Bad diagnosis.
The diagnosis is essentially, in our view, wrong. And we run a big risk that if we don't go back to basics, to the drawing boards on what is the diagnosis long term, we may get first to a cycle of the P word, as you said it, but on top of that, the P word will not address the real problem, and we will get into a spiral down of trouble. So I think it's time for all of us to think through the problem, to address the diagnosis, to talk about why jobs are being lost, why is it that the skills and the demands have a mismatch, and then collectively work on that. And I think that's where the opportunity for the region is.
James Lee, I just want to follow up on Susanna's comment on technology and also the comment on globalization. And one thing very interesting is about the mobile phone. I just left my phone with my friend at the front row. And yesterday I was at a reception. I took a photo of all of the cheese and sent it over to my friends in China. So really, technology or the internet, the phone, really make us feel physically much closer, that is, all together. I mean, in the past, before you know, I was able to send a picture from here back home right away, people probably feel Latin America is very far away, and now people feel that we are just very, very close together. So that's one, let's say, virtual reality is that we're all together. And second thing I also want to comment on, interestingly, while the phone, especially the phone more than the computer, brings us so much closer together, I flew over here and that still takes me the same number of hours as compared to 20 years ago, that is, the airplane has not been much faster, has been the same speed. But I guess both matter. One is that we feel we're very close together, and second, there is Latin America still quite far from where I live in Shanghai. So that's one observation. And second is, I guess it's more of a Chinese reality, but also probably impacts, does especially impact you know, a lot of places in Latin America, is that China's growth has slowed down. So what we want to call in the past, the growth in China was probably translated directly from the Chinese term, was a barbaric growth. That is, we just consumed a lot of energy, a lot of natural resources, and also a lot of pollution. And then that led to also a lot of problems. And now you simply cannot keep consuming energy and raw materials and just build roads and steel, you know, continuously forever. So China has really slowed down or trimmed down on those growth. But then we have to think about what next. So, you know, what I see, two things that people are closer together. So Latin America to everyone in China, especially Argentina, everybody knows, you know, the football. Maradona was a hero in the country in China. Yeah. okay. Yeah. So we are closer, and also we need to think about how to face slower, but also probably more, let's say, disciplined growth of China. And in addition, is we also have to face the new reality in the United States, what Hans Paul coined, populist growth.
But can I say one more thing? I mean, just also reflecting on what James and Susanna have been saying, I think we always try to separate globalization, technology, and so forth. And I think just building on what James has said, actually they are very deeply intertwined. Globalization without the technology would not be thinkable. I mean, the connectivity that has massively increased, that allows to move products and services at
great speed to have global supply chains or regional supply chains, again, would not have been possible without the technology. So I think when we try to diagnose what has gone wrong, you know, we need to see them in close sync. And I think one of the other things, we always argue with facts, and as a consultant, of course, I'm very analytical. I can give you all the statistics, and quite honestly, nobody cares. Yeah. Exactly. So when you talk to people in the street, they just don't care about this. And I think we need to, we must not underestimate the emotions. And you cannot address the emotions with more and more facts. That does not mean I don't agree with you, Susana. I'm just saying, I've tried this, and it doesn't work. So we need to find a new narrative, and we need to find real ways of helping people to move forward, to shape their own destiny, and to really feel that they really benefit.
But let me add something to that. When you look into the United States, just to be very direct and go to the heart of the issue, the reasoning is that the U.S. has lost jobs to globalization. You see the figures, as you said, people don't care about the figures, and there is a net increase in jobs in the United States in the last 8 years. The problem is that the type of jobs that are being created do not go to the Midwest where jobs are lost. They go to the coast where different profiles and skills are needed. So at the heart, yes, it's true that globalization is enabled by the ability to have more technology that gets us closer. But even if there was no globalization and everything was constrained within the country's boundaries, there is a shift in the type of jobs. And again, yes. The example of trucks being driven by nothing, by nobody, which will be a reality 10, 15, 20 years from now, and it's the biggest source of labor in the US, proves that we have something that goes beyond the technology as an enabler of globalization. Is the technology itself being disruptive to create different types of jobs, different added value jobs, but the old white collar jobs, basic jobs, are either going to be destroyed or are going to be stagnant in their income or even lose income. So that is part of the great challenge and concern and fear that people have. And you're right, people couldn't care less about figures, but how do you handle yes. that reality and how do you create the narrative for that reality? And more than creating the narrative, how do you tackle the issue so you find ways to move forward in a manner that people feel the opportunity to retool themselves? That's, to me, the biggest challenge.
Well, can I pick up on that? I think that, first of all, the jobs that were lost in the Midwest in the United States were blue-collar jobs rather than white-collar jobs. They were not lost to outsourcing, but to robotics. When I accompanied President Kuczynski to visit President Trump about two months ago, we mentioned that to him, and he said he was perfectly in agreement with that, or at least he nodded, giving an assent to that discussion. Clearly, that was not the message he was giving during the campaign that made him win. So that gives you an idea that still accuracy in communication is something to be cherished, whether we have great advances in technology or not. I think timing on the one hand and face-to-face interpersonal relations are important, not only on a social basis, on a business basis, or on a diplomatic basis, because as Susana can tell you, we have WhatsApps between a number of foreign ministers in Latin America. And it's perfectly, absolutely confusing. I have no idea what she's saying or what I'm saying, if I'm talking to her or talking to the Chilean ambassador or the Mexican ambassador. We have lots of rows, which we make up as soon as we see each other. So, I mean, so technology has a cutting edge as well. Thank you.
We need to move on to what you all came for, which is answers. But before we get there, I think it's important for us to address one more point. Is the new reality that we've been discussing here something to fear?
And I think we need to really make sure that people are not just looking at what Susana has described with fear, but see the opportunity. And I would like to go back one thing that worked on last year for the G20 B20 in Hangzhou in China. As part of one of the task forces, I mean, Jack Ma has been pushing the electronic worldwide trading platform. And that is really meant to enable tens of millions of people to build their own business, to reach out to customers around the world from wherever, from Argentina to China or Europe or wherever, or just to Brazil, or just to Cordoba from here. At the same time, also reach out to suppliers to do all the payments across the platform and to arrange for the logistics. So I think instead of only pointing out robotics and artificial intelligence will destroy, you know, all our jobs, starting with consultants and maybe also journalists from Bloomberg, sorry. it will leave the politicians in place still. So, you know, nobody has talked about replacing politicians yet. So that's the good news. But for the rest of us, it's tough. But I think, you know, to really demonstrate to people that actually technology will bring more opportunities. And I've seen people in Africa, you know, a young woman, you know, selling her fashion now in Europe via the internet and so forth, and actually getting paid, which is also good, and creating more jobs for sewing in Ghana. I think these are the stories which we need to have a lot more. And I'm sure that's also possible here in Argentina and across Latin America. So we need to be careful not just to paint a picture where we become all obsolete.
Well, may I say, I agree, but in the short term, I think at least in the next 2 years, we have a need to fear, or at least to be anxious, or at least to be careful, for two reasons. You the countries who are like-minded and likely to defend a renewal or resilience in the process of globalization are here. The region, Latin America, is committed to that. There's no doubt about that. However, you have 2 years of extraordinary, difficult, clumsy negotiations between the European Union and Great Britain, which is likely to have a negative effect on world economic growth, not just trade. You have these same 2 years during which time the Trump administration is unlikely to complete finishing getting organized at the senior level of the administration. That on the one hand, and finally, what you have at least as symptoms is the possibility of adversarial positions in terms of trade from the point of view of China and the United States, while at the same time there's a clear commitment to global retrenchment by the one indispensable power, as it likes to call itself, the United States.
Well, you know, uncertainty brings fear, whether you like it or not. And there is uncertainty in the world. So it is factual that there is fear floating there, going beyond the peoples, I mean, at the leadership level also. But I think there is also, as we discuss, opportunities. And yes, we talk a lot about what opportunities technology brings, but I will go back to basics. One of the biggest challenges the world faces is food security. And when you look at the risk inventory of what are the highest risks in the world, food insecurity is at the very top, because food insecurity, as much as water scarcity, will bring tensions and will bring a real problem between countries and within countries. Food security, going back to your point on the region, is an opportunity for the region. This is a region that could grow in the value chain in food security, providing not only self-security, which essentially is almost there, but provide a source of food and food security to other parts of the world. This is not going to go away. So one of the demands the world has, Latin America, Argentina can offer solutions for, but it's again not only providing the basic raw material, moving up in the ladder of the value chain, but also partnering and complementing other regions where South-South cooperation, learning from the experiences, can help build their own capacity. So this is one area where we as a region can build on and can secure part of our ability to develop. There are others, but I think that's one big example of an opportunity that we have to seize. Mm-hmm.
The question is about whether the new reality is a cause of fear. Actually,
Susana addressed the fact that it's a cause of fear, but is it something to fear?
Oh yeah, I think so. I'm actually, for a minority of people who drive Tesla, they're probably fearless. But for those who make diesel engine cars, I think it's they better be fearful. Take it actually a step further is that I think it is something to fear because the new reality really means there will be a lot of job shifts. And if you think about, it's easy to say that, especially students of economics, especially those who go to the elite American schools already think that free trade is good. But free trade does, create value. But for those people who have been making cars for the past 25 years and then once the car making shifted to another place, what do they do? You think they can quickly become IT, service professional? Probably won't happen. I mean, that's exactly what happened to the US election because people need jobs. So I think it is actually a pretty big concern that is the shifting paradigm will lead to a lot of wealth creation and all of new opportunities, and probably the pie itself becomes bigger, but a lot of people, regardless what percentage in the population, if they lose their jobs and then they cannot sustain a living or their original living standard, this will be a lot of problems. However, I do think that there are ways to address this. And again, this comes back to the idea of globalization. And also, since I come from China, I can probably adding a bit of a China element. Is that first? I think a lot of the jobs today about making things still need to be made by human beings. So that's probably won't change in the next 20 years. And the second thing is that China has become a pretty expensive country to make things. And the third is you notice China, in the past has been buying a lot of raw materials, natural resources, and it's time for China to think about where to put its money and its capital. Probably is a great idea to deploy the capital here and create jobs here and also look at Latin America as a local market and really a place to make and to sell. If you look at actually what happened to examples such as BMW or Toyota, they really go into the U.S. and make their cars, design and make and sell in the U.S. and that sort of became a pretty benign cycle. So,
may I just add on something on that? I think that there is another reason for a great deal of skepticism and rejection to the status quo. In South America in particular, because it also comes at a time, just this year, in which you have had an onslaught of systemic corrosive corruption from infrastructure companies in the country which is dearest to all of us in South America, a global leader with a distinguished relationship with all of us, which it has to reconstruct that relationship at the official level, and it's impossible to reconstruct because of the nature of that corrosive impact that it has had in at least 12 countries of the region. Whether we like it or not, opinion, people feel, read, and follow these issues, and that does not bode well for acceptance of the global order as it was before.
But I think we have, as political leaders, as business leaders, as the elites in many countries, I think we have a responsibility not just to reinforce the fear and tell people what they will not be able to do. But we need to find solutions. And I think there are many solutions. So taking up food security. Mm-hmm. If we can really, through also new technology, better supply chains, ensure that not a third of the food that is being produced is rotting or wasted, we can feed a lot more people. Sustainability, we haven't mentioned that. It's a big issue. We need to protect our environment. We can be much more energy and resource efficient, also with new technology. We can also really help people in schooling, education. A lot more children around the world could get better education also through new technology. Healthcare, sharing this even in the most remotest areas and so forth. And I think that will also create jobs. We will move from more manufacturing to more service jobs. And I think that is what we have to demonstrate and that we have to bring to the people rather than continue, sorry for being so a bit pushy on this, talking too much about fear. Yes, there are fears, there are emotions, but you know, I like the book from Steve Jobs, Only the Paranoid Survive. I'm also a bit paranoid. Paranoid is not bad because it brings the best out of you. Okay. But I think, you know, fear that makes people destroy what they're having, or you know, stagnate or withdraw, I think is bad. So we need to open up and we need to demonstrate and show what is possible.
Clearly, practical solutions will be required. But before we get there, here's a question that this region has to confront. Every country in this region needs to confront, perhaps every company in this region needs to confront, because it's not strictly a matter of foreign policy. In some cases, it's a matter of corporate policy. Should Latin America and its constituent member states and companies pivot away from the United States at this time? And if so, to what? Do you pivot inward? Do you strengthen regional ties? Do you pivot toward China? And if so, how do you redefine your relationship with China beyond raw materials and commodities? Or do you pivot across the Atlantic to Europe?
Well, if I may.
Sure.
Sorry.
We got go ahead.
I could say all of the above.
Yes.
I mean, it's just clear that when the tectonic plaques move, you have two possibilities. You are a squeeze between them, or new opportunities open up. So we need to be fast on our feet to make sure we are not a squeeze. We jump away from that squeeze, but we really seize the opportunities. And those opportunities are come in multiple forms. First of all, let's talk Latin America itself. The direct investment in Latin America within the region is at a low level that is only an opportunity. The trade within the region is at such a level that it's only an opportunity. The fact that Mexico has to deal with these tensions with his northern neighbor brings opportunity to have Mexico closer looking into the south and for us to work within the region. That is for the region itself. Do we have to walk away from the US? Now talking about Argentina, our trade with the US is at a level that is it also has only eventual opportunities. It's clear
nowhere to go but up.
It's clear that Europe has been looking into other places and now realizes that not only from a policy political perspective is good to relate to Latin America, but it gives them back certain level of leadership to do so. China is a reality. We cannot not deal with China. It's true that we have to sit with China and talk in terms of what are our needs, our strength, our capacities, and we have to work into a model that is convenient for China, but it's also convenient for the region. Let's not forget Africa. Africa is an opportunity for the region, a great opportunity, which I think in general terms, the region has totally underestimated, except for Brazil, which did something during the period that Lula was president. Essentially, we have underestimated. And going beyond that, the whole of Asia is an opportunity. So the question here is not which one we choose. We need to look into all of them. The biggest question is, do we bet on a system that is rules-based and is really embraces all of us or not? And that is something that my belief is the region is totally convinced that the rules-based system where we are all part of it is essential.
May I just compliment what I agree exactly with what Foreign Minister Malcorra has just said, but just to give you a practical example, we were the venue for the APEC meeting in November of 21 leaders, including Chinese leader Putin, Japan, etc., and we invited the Christine Lagarde from the IMF to give her own view of the situation. It was extremely successful. In the case of Latin America, not just Peru because we were the venue, but I think that most of the middle-income emerging countries of Latin America, not just South America, have a situation which is almost privileged in the sense that we have trade agreements with the United States, which, by the way, Trump is happy to continue on. trade agreements with China, trade agreements with the European Union, plus another 24. In the case of Peru, I think Chile has something like 80. That's not likely to reverse. On the contrary, it's likely to be complemented. That's on the one hand. On the other hand, we have probably the most effective, most rapid growing, most monitored integration scheme in Latin America, in the Pacific Alliance, or Alianza del Pacifico, as we call it, which involves Chile, Peru, Colombia, and Mexico. We've had a series of meetings, and in fact, we had a teleconference among the four heads of state of those countries just 2 weeks ago, and we will meet in Cali at the level of heads of state in June. This is a process which not only has stimulated the growth of trade, services, and the complementary stocks exchange of those four countries, but now has added on free flow of finance. So you have a platform of essentially one large-scale economic along the coast of the Pacific. Clearly, that's important, not just to our Asian partners, but it's important to Europe. Tomorrow and Friday, we have a meeting with the Mercosur to see what kind of links we can establish between the Pacific Alliance and Mercosur in order to enhance this movement. So clearly there's a commitment to the world which is not only not being damaged, is, as you have said, being stimulated to go forward.
Yeah, but I would ask myself, do you really need President Trump for Latin America to rethink how it's working together? The sense has been from the outside, with all due respect, and also due respect to the recent activities, I think that the Latin American countries have been quite closed. Yes, you are happy to export commodities and also minerals and oil and gas, but I think in terms of really letting competition in, come in, whether it's from neighboring countries or from the rest of the world, I think you see Latin America being still quite closed and following an import substitution policy for decades. So I'm making a black and white picture.
Not the case of the four countries I mentioned. Zero tariffs, zero ideas.
Okay. So, but I think, you know, that is, I think, the ultimate challenge for Latin America, to say, let's open up, let's also increase the cooperation within Latin America, because neighbors, I mean, in Europe, most of the trade happens within Europe. In Southeast Asia, in East Asia, most of the trade happens between those countries.
Well, but that's why I started by talking about within region, both
yes,
in terms of
I
trade
agree.
And
I
direct
do.
Investment.
And you don't need Trump as an excuse.
But I think that's the opportunity that opens up. Once you realize that your options are being curtailed by certain decisions beyond your ability to influence, then you reset the tone. Ricardo just referred to our meeting tomorrow between Mercosur and Pacific Alliance. I don't think this would have happened even a year ago.
But why not?
Well, but it hasn't happened.
There's a different system.
That's the reality. Now it is happening, and there is a strong commitment by Mercosur, by the four members that had discussed this. There is a strong commitment from the Pacific Alliance. There was an ideological divide that said Mercosur is in one direction and Pacific Alliance is in another one. Part of that was a certain level of self-protection. Now we all realize that this is not a zero-sum game.
Exactly.
And not being a zero-sum game and building on our strength, and here is, I want to emphasize this, is not being liberal in the terms that you open up and let everything flow without any control. You have agreements that are win-win, that build on your strength, that build on your mutual interests, and that allows for the pie to grow. And when the pie grows, definitely cannot be a zero-sum game.
May I just add to that it's not Trump as a pretext. I would like to mention that when we did meet, President Kuczynski did meet with this hour-long meeting in December, there was clear interest and now commitment on the part of the Trump administration not only to participate in the summit of the Americas, which take place about 10 months from now in Lima, but to organize a preview summit in the United States of CEOs from different enterprises different size levels of Latin America in the United States. So clearly, he's not backing away. That administration is not backing away. He's, on the contrary, committed to engaging. I think it's a question of the short term and the long term, so that we have to be prepared to go over this slightly difficult hump, which I mentioned is still extremely difficult, but in particular because of Brexit, and in particular because the United States needs to get its government organized. It's not only the case of Trump, previous administrations, the United States usually take from 6 to 9 months to get organized. This one will take 2 years, hopefully less, but that's the case. Thank you.
It seems to me that the panel has a consensus that open up and trade and competition, all these are beneficial. I think these are great things. I mean, I have two comments. One is, drawing from China's own experience, and China, 25 years ago, the economy was small and quite backwards, and what China did was really open up to everyone. And I can imagine Europeans, Americans, and also other countries all came to invest in China. And in those days, actually, foreigners in China enjoyed preferential policies, such as tax and other matters than local companies. But the result was that not only foreign companies did well, but also it created a lot of local companies. So I think, so this area, I think we do have a consensus that is opening and participation is good. But what I like to comment on is specifically is how, one of the big picture ideas are great, but how do you land this on the ground? That is how we really can translate the idea into an actual actions, actual benefit to the level of, let's say, a company, a municipality, and also the creation of jobs and taxes, on the ground. So I think that's probably a practical, a matter to think about.
Yes, I agree. We're going to open it up to the floor for questions in just a moment, but what should be on that action plan? If you're drawing up an action plan for Latin America to deal with the new reality, what's on there?
I think they're, investing in people. I think we all agree education, health is important. Investing in infrastructure, physical, but also digital infrastructure. Investing in financial markets and investing in strengthening institutions. You mentioned it earlier, Ricardo, on corruption, making sure that we have strong, transparent institutions that follow the rule of law, allow the rule of law for everybody to follow. I think these are key elements. And these are not new, but we have to really deliver, be very persistent, rather than making big action plans and then very little is happening. And that's why I think really step by step, country by country, making this work is key. And at the same time, I would say opening up more cooperation is helpful. Ricardo really emphasized that there was some divide in Latin America between Mercosur on the one hand, sorry for saying that, and the Pacific countries, on the other hand, in terms of how they open up their economies.
Well, I think that the name of the game is, on one side, integration. There is a need for infrastructure integration. UNASUR was created with integration as a theme, and we just totally forgot about it. So we need to go back to basics. In fact, we are going to be a presiding over Mercosur starting, over UNASUR starting in April, and that's the emphasis we are going to be discussing with all member states. Go back to the drawing board and talk about the integration of the electric grids, about telecommunication integration, digital integration, power in general, logistics. We flying within the region is a nightmare. You need to, our hub is in Panama or in Miami or in some place in Brazil. It's just plain horrible. So the integration is a key element to make us competitive as a whole. And in building the integration, you need to invest on infrastructure, which is in itself short term a source of jobs, which is also good. Of course, investing on education is another element of key element on this, and we need to work on that. And good governance, no question. And by the way, just to pass a little message, we are working now on WTO. We are going to host the WTO ministerial at the end of the year. That's a big theme for us as Argentina, but also for the region. And we are going to preside over G20 next year. And jobs is going to be at the center of our agenda, as much as what is the gap in education that is required in order to fill the needs of jobs.
let's open it up to the.
Let me just mention.
You want to add something?
Add to that. Just basically, I think UNASUR was born, as you mentioned, not only as a forum for pushing forward the connectivity of South America and the avoiding the isolation of the hinterland, but it was also a forum based on democratic representation, economic, and that those two were the basic tenets. It was hijacked in the meantime. Mm-hmm. Hopefully in April we'll be back to the drawing boards.
Back to basics.
Thank you.
All right, let's give members of the audience an opportunity to ask some questions. Please raise your hand. We have people with microphones. If you would do the panelists the favor, please identify yourselves before asking the question. There was one actually back there. Yes, that lady in the black. Yes, she's waving her hand. You're first.
Hi, my name is Andrea Sangil. I'm a global shaper from the San Jose Hub in Costa Rica. My question was related to, we're talking about globalization, but we're narrowing it down basically to trade. How can we think about globalization in a more human way? Where globalization is affecting issues such as climate change, as migration, loss of jobs, etc. So thinking about migration, we're making it easier for trade, for services and goods to move around the world very easily, but not people. So how can we think about connecting each other? It's easier to feel closer to the ones that are far away right now with globalization, but once people we don't know are close, we don't like them. So how can countries approach this challenge that I think is very linked to globalization to find a more human side of this concept? Thank you.
Well, it's clear that when you talk about the free flow that globalization brings, is the free flow of financing, the free flow of goods and services, and it's the free flow of people. That is at the heart of the problem in the European Union at this very moment. That's one of the reasons why the Brexit took place. And part of that is not the free flow of Europeans, it's the free flow of people trying to come into Europe, which goes to the migrants question. From our perspective, we are deep believers of migration. I mean, we are a country of migrants. I learned something today. It was information that I sort of knew, but I got the number. 70% of the Latin Americans that migrate to Argentina. So we are still today a very strong migrant country. It's just a matter of how do you reconcile with the notion that expanding your base is good news for everybody, and how do you reconcile, and that's I think the point in the case of Europe, on how to support and finance that reality, which is a big challenge. But you're right, you can not only talk about the economic aspects or the hard aspects of globalization if you don't add the third pillar, which is the people's aspect. And that is one of the central issues that we have to deal with as we seek solutions towards the future, because if we do not solve the problems of the peoples in their place, they are going for sure going to migrate. And that again takes me back to the question of food and water security.
Well, I mean, just say that Latin America, in particular the Andean region, is a region which is multi-ethnic in its origin and also extraordinarily composed of many sources of migration, particularly Peru, which is part of its richness, is probably the essence of its richness. And I think that's what makes it so easy for the four countries, but in particular the three countries of the four countries of the Pacific Alliance, to make the flow of people within from Chile, Peru, and Colombia all that easy, not only in terms of tourism, but in terms of business opportunities, etc. I think the problem there is that not only is that we have a slightly more vital emerging economy in this region as opposed to the developed world, but it's also a question that we are finally becoming more pragmatic and less rhetorical, whereas the old world is becoming more ideological and obsessive. Mm-hmm. And that's something which is at the heart of populism and which affects migrants and the whole issue of refugees when there shouldn't be that sort of issue. Secretary General Guterres is an extraordinary asset to the world community because he comes from a job which understands the whole refugee crisis, and I just hope that we can provide the commitment that we have to a renewal of globalization, to a renewal of world governance under his aegis. Thank you very much.
Let's move on to the next question. There are quite a number of hands in the room. Gentleman here in the front row.
Thank you very much. My name is Daniel Sobato. I'm the Regional Director of International IDEA. I'm glad to hear at the very end that you mentioned G20. There are three main countries in the region, Mexico, Argentina, and Brazil. Besides the commercial, the trade integration, are you talking in order to integrate from a foreign policy perspective how to influence globalization? Because my sense is that you are trying to adapt to globalization. How much committed are these three countries now working together in order to influence globalization? And not only that, how to influence more in the UN, for instance, having a much better coordination at the UN Security Council, in the World Bank, at the IMF, and so forth. What is the plan there?
Well, the countries that you mentioned are the three largest countries, but they don't have necessarily the same general specific global policies. The countries that I mentioned that have specific economic and global policies is the Pacific Alliance countries, which are Chile, Peru, Colombia, and Mexico. So there you have a little bit more of like-mindedness in terms of economic issues. In terms of global issues, climate change, refugees, security, etc., we are all in Latin America pretty much like-minded. Peru will be joining the Security Council as a non-permanent state in January of next year. Clearly, we're following with enormous interest the crisis, which is also part of the underbelly of globalization. It's not just the refugee crisis, it's the horrendous massacres taking place in Syria, for example, etc. So you're dealing with countries which have been always progressive in terms of the liberal order, and that's not changed, not at all. The degree of commitment and emphasis, of course, depends on the ability and the seriousness of the governments that you're talking about, specific governments that you're talking about.
Well, just to build on what Ricardo has said, I think the region is essentially a multilateral region. I mean, we all adhere to the principles, and I think one can argue that the strongest institutions belong to the region, OAS and the Charter precede the United Nations. But let me go specifically to the G20. What we are trying to do here is build a view on the G20 that comes from Latin America. And in fact, we did for the first time, we had a forum last week, where we had the Sherpas of Mexico, Brazil, and Argentina discussing what could be a Latin American agenda to be brought to G20. We are going to expand that to other countries beyond the ones that have a presence in the G20 to reflect on what the region needs and can contribute to the G20. In fact, what we have said is that we see Argentina as bringing a vision from the south that builds into the G20. We all know the strength and the weakness of the G20 regarding representation, and we believe that there is an opportunity to contribute with the southern perspective and to build on the things that were put on the table by China in its presidency that now are furthered by Germany. So, that is the duty we feel we have as the chair of the G20 next year.
And other questions? Hands, please. Lady in the front row here in the red.
Hello, Naomi Hernandez. I'm a global shaper from the San Salvador Hub. I really like the idea that was brought up in the panel about not a disjunctive view of getting away from the US or leaning to China or leaning to Asia or either one of those, but all of them together and strategically thinking about how we can build a strategy of doing all of them. How do you think that us from the civil society can influence the view of our country and of our representatives to do exactly that?
Well, first of all, in the 21st century, one cannot think about building policy only from a government perspective. If one takes that road, that is for sure a dead end. So what we have to do is socialize these concepts and test them against the views of civil society, of unions, of the private sector business community, because all of us together can only build whatever we see as a solution. So again, going back to the G20 idea, what we are planning to do is really to socialize these questions and bring opportunities to all the groups and civil society represented in different ways, from a women's perspective, you know, in order to make sure that we mainstream the agenda in a manner that people feel associated with the notion that in the end, us as government have an overarching responsibility, but that is the way to go.
Hands. And, there's someone here in the gray suit.
Elias Selman, Pro America Con.
Elias Selman.
That are performing very different. One that been performing very well that belong to Alianza del Pacifico, meaning Mexico, Colombia, Peru, and Chile. And the other one has been the country from the Mercosur that are really not performing well and their economy is still very close. We have seen some changes in the last 2 years. For example, Mr. Macri, who Mrs. Malcorra represent, they're turning the old policies to looking for more opening of the economy, more private sector performance, or more friendly to the private sector. And then there's something that is missing in this panel, is Brazil. I think Brazil is a question mark. If Brazil is a question mark, I would like to ask Mrs. Malcorra, are you willing as Argentina to look to join the Alianza del Pacifico in the case Brazil as a question mark remain in the same kind of old policy to be more close?
Well, first of all, it is clear that Brazil has gone through a challenging political process within the established institutions of the Constitution. I want to highlight that because it was a challenge, but they did pursue this within the constitutional arrangements. Now we have a situation in Brazil where the government is clearly with the view of opening up and integrating first to Mercosur, and I can assure you all the last visit that President Macri made to Brasilia, where President Temer and President Macri committed to Mercosur, was a solid work plan of things to be done in the short and medium term that will make a difference and an impact within Mercosur. A real breaking down barriers within Mercosur, which is the first duty we have. But from there, we also committed to a projection of Mercosur to all of the above, as I said before, in a very, very strong manner. And we discussed there the notion of the Mercosur Pacific Alliance a closeness. And I was tasked as the chair of Mercosur, as the presidency of Mercosur, to produce a meeting as soon as possible, which we are doing tomorrow. And I'm sure this meeting will not be one where we are going to only talk. There will be deliverables coming out of that meeting. So what I'm saying here is, yes, it's true that each one of us has challenges, internal challenges, has things to overcome, including our neighbor Brazil, which we rely and depend so much on. But the sense we have is there is an understanding that the old way of being anchored down, being close, being based on internal market, on import replacement, import substitution, has gotten us to where we are. It won't get us to where we should be, and that is commitment.
I hate to slightly rain on Susana's parade, and I'm sure that we will come up with something out of the meeting tomorrow, but I really want to be frank. When I mentioned a corrosive corruption scandal at the heart of South America, I was talking about Brazil. Brazil is in intensive care, not only for its own political institutions, but because in mixture of some political parties who were in government and major transnational companies have produced the breakdown of confidence between the government elites, the people, and the business elites in 12 countries of South America. That cannot be waved away with a handkerchief or a handshake.
But I think it's also, I mean, looking from the outside, it's also a great opportunity to clean up. So I think the crisis was really needed. And given that the scandal has such proportions, I think it makes it painfully obvious for everybody that this has to happen, this cleanup has to happen. And I think I'm quite confident, I think, again, looking from the outside, you probably know things much better, that it will happen. And I think that's why, in many ways, again, a crisis that really is an opportunity for Latin America.
Before I conclude, James, an opportunity for you to have the last word.
I passed this because this is quite ancient America.
Very diplomatic. An excellent conversation. Panelists, thank you very much. I'm going to summarize. Yes, please, let's give them a hand for sure. I agree with James. There was some consensus among the group about what constitutes the new reality and whether it is something to fear. I like the way that we framed the presidency of Donald Trump. Opportunity or excuse, I like that one. And also there's clearly an agreement that this doesn't have to be a zero-sum game. There are opportunities as Latin America redefines its relationship internally and with the rest of the world for win-win agreements. What we got to, it seems to me that what we got to at the end with some of the, well, this, you know, we could spend a lot longer on the action plan, right? What clearly investment is required, whether it's in education, whether digital infrastructure, financial markets, institutions, more cooperation and openness, integration of infrastructure. I think we all agree it is pretty tough to fly around this region, but also in telecom and power, in logistics, excellent, and the need for good governance ever present, not just here, but everywhere around the world. Some excellent questions from the audience. Ladies and gentlemen, I thank you, and please join me in thanking our panelists, Susana Malcorra, the foreign minister here in Argentina, Ricardo Luna, the foreign minister of Peru, Hans-Paul Berkner, the chairman of Boston Consulting, and James Im, the CEO of EJ McKay. Thank you. Thank you.